Hello again. We've reached chapter 5 of John Wesley Brady, This Freedom Whence? England Before and After Wesley. This chapter is entitled Dawn Deferred. He starts with three short quotes from Jonathan Swift, the author of Gulliver's Travels, from Jonas Hanway, An Earnest Appeal for Mercy to the Children of the Poor, and from Samuel Johnson, the greatest man of letters of that day. Swift says, and this is a work called Project for the Advancement of Religion, Swift says, I do not remember that our English poets ever suffered a criminal amour to succeed upon the stage until the reign of Charles II. Ever since that time, the alderman is made a cuckold, the deluded virgin is debauched, and adultery and fornication are supposed to be committed behind the scenes as part of the action. So Swift, who was a minister, by the way, commenting on the state of literature in his day. Jonas Hanway, in an earnest appeal for mercy to the children of the poor, 1766, says, It is certain the apprenticeship of some parish children is as great a scene of inhumanity as the suffering others to die in infancy. And Samuel Johnson, in his work London, his poem London, in 1738, said this, Here malice, rapine, accident conspire, and now a rabble rages, now a fire. Their ambush here relentless ruffians lay, and here a fell attorney prowls for prey. Here falling houses thunder on your head, and here a female atheist talks you dead. So we are in the chapter Dawn Deferred, which is talking about John Wesley's influence, but not before it basically tells us what the project had to face before it could get really started in the middle classes of England. Dawn Deferred. Light literature, including comic drama, has in every age striven to hold a mirror to the fashion and foibles, the habits and humors, the manners and morals of contemporary life. Coordinated imagination and artistic latitude here, of course, are freely allowed. But unless the action and atmosphere are consonant with current experience, such literature has scant hope of wide appeal. What then of the light literature of the early and middle 18th century? Beyond doubt, it emits an odor of scented sickliness that never would have been tolerated in a healthy age. Sir Walter Besant, in his comprehensive volume, London in the 18th Century, writes, quote, The coarseness prevalent in the 18th century, the gross indecency and ribaldry of its songs, of the daily and common talk, makes itself felt in the whole of its literature, in the plays, the poems, the essays, and the novels. The grossness belonged not only to the poor wretch of a harlot, but to all classes alike, end of quote. Among the many characters, for example, in Gay's sweeping success, The Beggar's Opera, which was 1728, one looks in vain for a single honest person. True, Addison, Steele, Richardson, Johnson, and Goldsmith worked hard to stop the rot, but to the vast mass of their countrymen, they were asking water to run uphill. The taste for the pornographic was avid, the drift of the era was toward the pedantic, the sensual, the vulgar. Even clergymen like Swift and Sterne could not resist the lure of the coarse and the prurient. Neither could such would-be reformers as Defoe, Fielding, and Smollett always keep their pages quite clean. While as for the more popular scribblers, many of them women, they won their following by gilding and mirroring dirt. The moral standards of Richard Sheridan were far from prudish. Yet in The Rivals, written in 1774, when private and public morals had already greatly improved, he made Sir Anthony Absolute define a circulating library as an evergreen tree of diabolical knowledge, while 14 years earlier, George Colman, in the concluding words of his drama, Polly Honeycomb, wrote, quote, A man might as well turn his daughter loose in Covent Garden as trust the cultivation of her mind to a circulating library, unquote. Lecky points to the prevailing coarseness of the literature of the first half of the century, and Sir Walter Scott has recorded the experience of his great aunt, a grand aunt rather, who in old age turned again to the pages of Aphra Behn, B-E-H-N, whose novels she had delighted in when she was young, but she then found herself unable to read without shame a book which 60 years before she had heard read for amusement in the best society in London. End of quote. Goldsmith, too, maintained that most novels of his time were no better than instruments of debauchery. The next segment, how about the drama, the general drama and the theater of the mid-1700s?